It's an honor and a privilege to be able to talk to you about what Mary and I have experienced over the last couple of weeks. Like Pastor said, we went down to Family Life. Probably most of you have heard about Family Life, Dennis Rainey, Family Life, Weekends Remember, the I Still Do's, and all the stuff. Family Life is huge, you know, all over the world, the globe, internationally and that. So probably most of you have heard about them. Probably some of you have spent some Weekend Remembers with them. That's where Mary and I went a couple, year and a half ago, whatever it was, and kind of felt God's tugging to maybe go in this direction. So we had you guys praying about it for a while, and we went down there. Like we talked about before, it was a long application process. I mean, it was a long effort. It took me a couple months to finish. And then the references, and if they like you, then they call you back. You do some phone interviews, and if they like you, then they'll extend an invitation to come down and visit them for like 4 days. So we didn't really know what God was wanting us to do. We felt the calling kind of go towards the family life. It's exciting, yet scary. You know, because it's missionary work. So you gotta quit the security of your own job and just go out and raise support, and like my boss called it, begging for money. But then quite he doesn't understand how it works, you know. So it was a big change if that's what God was gonna be leading us that way. And so it was an open door, so we decided to pursue that open door. So we went down for the 4 days a week ago, last Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And, I mean, the 4 days, we hated to leave on Saturday. I mean, it was really, I mean, the 4 days we were there, we just really bonded with a lot of people. Like Dennis Rainey and met Bob Lapine, saw them speak on the radio. And just, every minute you were being interviewed by couples. I mean, it was just a long, lengthy process, man. So we got to be friends with a lot of people down there, and it just was kind of a heart-wrenching to come back on Saturday. And so we're going to kind of share about what transpired those 4 days. I'll get into what their decision was about us. They did make a decision, so kind of a decision, so I'll kind of get into the details about that. But I'm going to let Mary start off, and she can talk to you about what God talk to her about these last 4 days. So,
I had to wait for that. Well, I never imagined that 4 days could be so life-changing. When we got to the hotel, there was a goodie bag, and in it were prayer cards, just like this. Not just one, not just a couple, but 29. The staff had been praying for us, and this is just one example. Randy and Mary, welcome to Little Rock. I pray your time here will be used by God to give you a clear picture of what He desires for your future. The best option is obedience. Praying for unity for you as a couple and courage to listen and obey. Blessings. Chad Daly. And they were all full cards and some in the back as well. And Randy read them to me when we got there and we sat down and got a little choked up about it. And there seemed to be a theme over all of the cards, which was praying for discernment, praying for unity, praying for protection from the enemy. And we were greatly protected as well. And the first night that we were there, we got a chance to meet a little bit with the other couples. There were five of us couples total. And each of us sat at a different table with staff. So we would kind of get to know each other a little bit. The food was fabulous. They feed you well. And they introed the staff. They did a small presentation, and then they did the couple intro. And the other emphasis there, that there was a reason that we were called. Whether we were called for family life, you know, even if family life didn't choose us, or we didn't choose them, that God would use this time in a very mighty way, and He really did. And so after the first night, it was really exciting, and I got back to the room, tired. And Thursday morning came around, and we all hopped on the bus, took our ride out there, and we were greeted by the staff that was there. They have a big rotunda in the, when you first walk in, a stairway. It's just, the building is just beautiful. We walked in and there was staff all applauding for all of us that were coming in. Yeah, welcome, glad you're here. And it was kind of brought me to tears. It was really exciting. And Thursday happened to be our longest day there. There was so much to learn. And we had the opportunity to meet with Dennis, where we took a picture of all of the couples. So we have a nice little remembrance of our trip. And the ministry, they talked about the call. And one of the talks, or in one of them, there was one of the other missionary couples. They kind of shared their journey and what they did. But it was a title that talked about spiritual decision-making. And one of the gentlemen said that you can't deal a card that God cannot play. And I just thought that it was profound and excellent. Couldn't help but write that down. It really impacted me. And then it came time for one of the challenging things. They interviewed each one of us separately to see if we were kind of in unity on the same page. And when we got a chance to come back together again, we kind of, you know, where were you and what did you say? One of the main questions was, so on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being not at all and 5 being where are you? Where are you? They asked each one of us that. And so Randy's like, well, I'm all in. I said 5. And I said, really? I said, I haven't heard enough. I said 3. And if you guys know anything about us, that is completely the opposite of how we usually are. I'm just like, yeah, let's go. And Randy's like, can we just wait a little bit? So it was an interesting message. And so that whole day was just absorbed with so many different things to do. And then Friday morning came around. We went for a worship time. It was an awesome time in one of the large boardrooms. And again, the little snacks and the food was really good. Gluten-free scones. Couldn't get her to give me the recipe, but wonderful. And they started to talk about something called MPD, Ministry Partner Development. And one of the other missionaries kind of shared what their take on MPD was, my profound dependence. We're really dependent upon God to do the things. Were we listening to what he had to say to us? Because we really still weren't sure. And one of the things that they talk about development is raising support. They gave a little talk about what that would consist of. And one of the things that they talk about in your calling is that they have an initial training that they do that you would raise support. And this raising initial support in the expected time is used as a confirmation of God's call in our life to serve with family life supported staff. And Friday was nice because we were just so overwhelmed with everything and our book and paperwork and things. So Friday they gave us an opportunity to spend time together, and they gave us a little missions assignment and in the Word. And it was time for us, I remember, I was just kind of sitting up, and Randy was kind of laying down, and we were just going over Scripture and how God was moving us in a certain direction and what impact did all of this have. And Saturday, as we were kind of getting ready to go, Bob Lapine had a devotional. And I think it was really exciting because in September, when I went to the True Women Conference, Bob Lapine was also one of the speakers there, and I had a chance to walk up to him and say, hey, you know, we're kind of candidating for family life and seeing what that's all about, and can you do me a favor? Can you pray that we sell our motorcycle because we're still in some debt, and we were kind of hoping that we would be able to sell our motorcycle which we were able to do. So I was able to share that story, and Bob and Nancy, Dan and Nancy happened to buy the motorcycle from us, which is, it was so cool. And the neatest thing is, if you want to use it again, feel free. So we gave it away, and God gave it back to us, so that affirmed the call. And one of the other things that they did was they separated the men and the women the last day before we were leaving and taking pictures. And in our group, they talked a little bit about what it was like to be a wife and a woman of God, and where are your priorities. And so it was it was an emotional time. And how would I be as listening to what God has called me to do? How would I be the support and the encourager that my husband needs in all of this? And I learned a lot about me as well in that whole process. And then we came to the decision time. And I will turn that over to Randy, and he can share what was said at that meeting.
All right. Well, like I mentioned before, it was an awesome, awesome opportunity. And I did go there with the intention, I mean, I was all gung-ho. You know, I was just all excited. This is what God wanted us, and I was ready to move forward, and everything looked good. And so there's three answers. At the end of the 4 days, they meet with you as a couple. I mean, it's the last meeting before the shuttle driver comes by and book you off the airport. You don't even get to see any of their couples afterwards, because I think they're still, they have evaluators. They're evaluating each one. And they said we went to lunch with a different evaluator, went to dinner with a different evaluator. So, I mean, they were forever evaluating you and interviewing you. Number one, they want to make sure this is God's calling. I mean, not just for you, but for family life, too. Because you may feel it's God's calling, but it may not be. You know, so they're just they're working on their discernment. And, in fact, one of the dinners we went to with Carol and Doug, which is our top evaluator. One thing they noticed about us is that we wanted to do the same thing, but we weren't like on the same page, you know, which is kind of weird. But during dinner, they said, this is what we noticed. You know, Mary is this direction and you're this direction, and it's kind of going the same way, but you're not together on the same page. So that's something they picked up on. And then another thing they picked up, when she called us yesterday and talked to us, and one of the things, I mean, this is how close they're kind of watching everything. She said, one of the things that they noticed about Mary and I is when we talked about our aspiration, our goals and that, we didn't have any eye contact. We weren't like looking at one another as we're talking. And I did notice that through all that, when, you know, everything done there with husband and wife, every time she would talk, he would look, and vice versa. And all the couples, you know, they all had that interaction where they were looking back and forth, you know. So they said, you know, when you raise your support, this is something you, one of the things you need to be, you know, constantly, you need to be looking back and forth with one another. You need to be as a team, you know. So they're like, you know, they're like observing. Every time you walk around, you're just kind of like watching you moving. And our first Wednesday there, and I had no idea who the guy was sitting next to me, but he was our decision maker at the end, but he was the manager of all this, what we're going through. I mean, so he was the top dog. And I had no idea. I'm sitting with the top dog, you know, picking my teeth and kind of, you know, making fun of myself and kind of doing all kinds of stupid stuff in here. So I said, so what do you do? Oh, I run this whole new staff development thing. I was like, oh, did they say anything that, like, embarrass me, or should I leave now, or, you know? But it was exciting. And he's been with them for quite a while, for 15, 20 years, I think. And his wife passed away about 2 years ago, so now he's a widower, but still there. But so through all this process, we come down to the last, you know, we had devotions, we took pictures of all the couples, and all of a sudden the evaluators came out and said, you good me. So we all go our different way. So we ended up going with this guy. His name's Sandy, the guy that I was sitting next to. Because our top evaluator, Carol, had to be sick that day, so she didn't come in Saturday, so we went with Sandy. And so he went through the whole process. So, you know, he says, Randy, you're an elder. You do that, Mary, you do all that, You list all the good stuff about us. However, well, before I get to that, I should say that, now, Mary and I didn't talk, but we kind of thought there was, well, here's the three answers. They either say, yes, we want you, or no, we don't want you, or wait. That was the three decisions. And so Mary and I, going into this, we didn't really talk to each other, but she thought it was gonna, the thing was going to be wait, because, you know, they want their budget people. Everything's going to be budget. And that's why we had to sell the bike and pay off debt, be debt-free, because you can be a missionary. So we didn't have a budget in place. So without her telling me, that's in her back of her mind, she's thinking budget. And I'm thinking that, the job thing would be difficult, because I travel and, you know, and it just kind of wasn't going to work out. And so we both had these weight things, but we both didn't share with each other. So, I mean, this is part of their discernment coming out. So, again, he goes through all this great stuff that is great about both of us. However, he says, what we haven't seen with you is that you have both taught a class or both did a project or something together. She does her thing, and I do my thing. For years, I do my thing, she does her thing, and it never dawned on us that we never did our thing, you know, and what's family life all about? I mean, all these are couples that are missionaries there, they do their thing, they work together, you know, God calls them together, and so it just, it made sense. I mean, I wasn't disappointed at all, like, oh, I gotta wait, you know, it was just kind of like an eye-opener, it was like, you know, you're right. We've never done our thing. It's always been God's thing, but separately, doing it individually. So I think you were maybe slightly disappointed, only because it wasn't a yes thing, maybe.
Yeah.
But that lasted a minute or two. So he said, what we would like you to do is go back to your home church and teach a art of marriage couples course, which made total sense. Because during this time, this 4 days up there, Mary and I were drawing closer to each other. I've been married for 19 years, but we're drawing closer together just by being in this atmosphere that they're providing up there. And that, so we're getting closer. And now they want us to teach this Art of Marriage Connect, Building Your Marriage to Last book. They said, you go back and teach that. And then when you're done, then you get back with us. So this was, I don't want to call it our assignment, because that sounds bad, even though I think he did use the word assignment. So it's not an assignment, but it's, right now, the way I think we're looking, Mary and I have been communicating a lot lately, and the way we've been looking at it is, you know what, this is our next step. Has God called us to family life? We don't know yet. Maybe he brought us up there, number one, to draw us closer together, which it has. Like I said, most couples that go up there don't join staff, but it's God uses that time for his good. You know, so maybe, you know, number one, we've already gotten closer. Number two is for us to come back and teach the church. You know, I mean, believe it or not, I mean, there's a lot of married couples here, and I'm sure we're going through different struggles. There's no perfect marriage out there. So maybe what God wants us to do is to come back and go through this course with married couples here in church and continue doing that here. I don't know what God's got. All I know is they didn't say yes. They didn't say no. This is what they want us to do. So this is our next step that we're going to do. And during this time, I got a couple, three videos up there. Man, this is, but you know, one of the things I learned up there was to like listen to Mary. You know, listen. I mean, have we all been accused of men? Have we all been accused like, hey, you don't listen to me. You look right at me, but you have no idea what I'm saying. Does it sound familiar?
Yeah.
Never heard that. And you can get a lead now. Well, there's a product for that. Men, there's a product for that, and it's pretty inexpensive. So if you've been accused of being a pea brain, I want you to watch this first video.
Which one's the first one?
The first one. Yeah, the comedy one, I think.
The which one?
Did it say comedy? Or
okay, yeah.
Funny or whatever? If not, it's okay. Let me...
How many times has this happened to you?
To me. You know, we our babies sleep really, really good.
Or this.
Make sure Timmy wears the blue shirt.
Or even this.
And for my birthday, which is next month, I'd really like some of this.
Do you have trouble listening or retaining information from your wife? You could be suffering from spousal selective listening, or SSL. With SSL, valuable input is intercepted or scrambled before it reaches the pituitary of the man brain. Virtually anything can trigger it, like sports, food, even shiny objects with buttons. Fortunately, there is help with Hiratol. Containing a rare group with an exotic name, Hiratol helps men focus and listen to valuable female input, even pick up on those subtle hints.
These are exactly the earrings I wanted. How did you know?
Thanks, Hiratol. Now I can hear it all.
Hiratol has not been tested or approved by any regulatory agency. Side effects of Hiratol include minor to severe headaches and spontaneous combustion. Use caution with regard to Hiratol. That would be previously been ignored. Hiratol is not used for children or cousins if possible. Blue-haired women. It focuses on lasting 1 to 4 hours. Consult your doctor immediately before your wife assumes this is a new standard in your relationship. Men with wives who are nursing or pregnant should not take this product. Hiratol, the preferred selection or solution for selective hearing.
But wait, now, by now, we'll double your offer. You know, you heard that.
Randy, I figured out how to get your support. Just sell that.
Just sell that. You know, Tom, maybe a good idea. So, men, does that somewhat look like, I mean, I've been guilty of it, you know, when you think you're paying attention and maybe you're playing with a shiny object or... Maybe your brain does a static thing, kind of goes out of focus and that, but I thought that was true, you know, it was pretty hilarious. So, Family Life's mission is to effectively develop godly marriages and families who change the world one home at a time. If you take small bites, we change one home at a time. And then their mission is every home to be a godly home. So that's what family is all about. I mean, I knew they were big in that, but just being part of it, being down there for the 4 days, it's just unbelievable what they do. We got to see Bob Lapine and Dennis Rainey do it. They were in the booth. They were doing a radio station program and that. And so they do everything with excellence there. So I really, really, and I want you to pray about this starting maybe this moment. Does God want you to be part of this study? Now, this is for... it's a couples only thing. So we have books. We purchase books. We've got 16 books. They're like $10 a piece. So if you want to be part of it, $10 a piece. If you want to be part, you don't have $10. I don't care. Grab a book. Be part of it anyway. Don't let any money hold you back. But we looked at this, and it's an awesome study. It's a 7-week course, so it's not very long. And the way they worked it up there, the way the Sandy, because he's taught this group too, he says he did it in 14 weeks. So what he did is 1 week, they did the study, and there's like a little, I hate to use the word, homework assignment, and I hate homework assignment. I don't know what they're doing, guys and women, I know you do too. But it's not a whole lot. There's a little assignment here for a couple to do. So what they've done is they've done a class every 2 weeks, and the week in between, they do, it's like a date night. So you and your husband or wife can just go and just do a date night. You know, it'd be a good excuse for a date night and just complete your little homework assignment. It's not very long. It doesn't take very much time. Or maybe, you know, you can take a date night. It gives you 2 weeks to do your little homework. Then you come back and meet. So it's a 7-week study. You drag it into 14 weeks. If that don't work, we'll be more happy doing 7 weeks. It's all up to the couples that want to decide. Couple of things in here I want to read to you, a couple questions and answers. I mean, and this is something that I used to start with a long time ago. Do we really need to be part of a group? I mean, can't we like just do it on our own? Can't we just have the moment and watch TV and do church on our own? Or why do I gotta go around? What's groups? You know, I mean, I don't need a group. Couldn't we just go through the study as a couple? Why can't you just do it on your own? You know, it's a good question. While you could work through the study as a couple, you would miss the opportunity to connect with friends and to learn from one another's experiences. You'll find that the questions in each session not only help you grow closer to your spouse, but they also create an environment of warmth and fellowship with other couples as you study together. So, yes, you can do it on your own, but it's a lot better if you do it with other people. Yeah. Camaraderie, it's more fun. You know, there's a lot of people going through the same stuff we're going through. The other question is, isn't it risky to talk about your marriage in the group? Share about your marriage, secret stuff. You know, once more, goes on behind closed doors. Well, the group setting should be enjoyable and informative and non-threatening. Three simple ground rules will help ensure that everyone feels comfortable and gets the most out of the experience. Number one, don't share anything that will embarrass your spouse. You may pass on any questions that you don't want to answer. And if possible, complete the couple's project between group sessions, if possible. So it's not mandatory, it just really helps you and your spouse bond together. Want to go to the next clip, video two?
Which one is that?
What are they labeled?
How to Fix Marriage Problems, The Art of Marriage, and The Art of Marriage Commercial.
Commercial.
Oh, hey, don't forget my parents are coming over for dinner tomorrow night.
Shh. Don't look now, but the Millers just walked in.
Oh, hey, Joanne.
What part of shh didn't you understand?
Why do I have to shush? I want to say hi.
Because it's awkward now.
Why is it awkward?
Because of the fact that the marriage is on the rocks.
What? Where'd you hear that? I talk to Joanne like every day. She never said anything.
Well, apparently she neglected to tell you that her and Bob have been a marriage counselor. Look at them all there. They're going to be all lovey-dovey. Like, breaks my heart. It really does.
I can't believe that. You sure?
Yeah. Remember at church Sunday when I went to the men's room to try to clean that strawberry jelly stain off my shirt? Totally overheard Bob telling some guy about it. It was like he was excited about it. How do you think they're going to split up the possessions? You ever see that large screen TV they have? I wonder if there's a way... somehow in the settlement that we can get that
to you. Are you talking about that Art of Marriage course that they're taking at church?
Hmm? Oh, yeah. I think I heard him say that. Art of Marriage. Nice name. It's like they're trying to make it seem like marriage is fun or something. It is. Very much so.
First of all, it's not marriage counseling. And second of all, it's not just for people whose marriage is on the rocks. It's for anyone who just wants to make sure their marriage doesn't go in the wrong direction.
Oh, no.
What?
I just thought of something. If they split up, I'm pretty sure that means they're not going to be having their annual Super Bowl party anymore.
Sucks. Frank, will you listen to me? This is not just for people whose marriage is in trouble. I even know engaged couples that are taking the course.
Okay, I'm no Dr. Phil, but a couple's not even married yet and they're already in marriage counseling. That's probably a pretty good sign that they shouldn't be together.
It's not marriage counseling.
Shh, lower your voice. They're going to hear you.
Okay, you're being ridiculous. Do you think every single person who's taken the Art of Marriage course, their marriage is in shambles?
Oh, I don't know. Would you go get your car washed if it were already squeaky clean? All I'm saying...
I signed you and me up to take the Art of Marriage course next weekend.
What? I knew it. I knew it. I knew our marriage was too good to be true. It's my snoring, isn't it? I could quit. I can stick cotton balls up my nose. Or one of those masks. I could kick this thing, Liz. For us.
Now, doesn't it make you just want to join? So what I want to show you is it's not for marriages that are on the rocks or struggling. I'm not going for that. It's for, you know, marriages that maybe are going great. You know, sometimes we just need a little tweak, a little tuning up, and we always get better. Can we men? We'll always be better. then I want to play the... I'm going to have to clean it for me for this next video. If you want to go to the next video, this is a more serious one.
There were very few people who knew what really went on inside our home.
Whenever we got in our discussions, I felt like I couldn't control the emotion that was going on inside of me.
I was a button pusher, and I knew what buttons to push.
My anger would just flare out of control, and it would turn into an explosion.
From friendly to horrible in a matter of seconds. I think he felt like things were swirling. I could out-talk him. I could take the entire situation, no matter what I had done in it. It could be about Hans. It could be his fault.
We were in an argument, and I grabbed her as hard as I could, and I threw her down on the bed. I had this little bit of justification that because I didn't actually physically lay a fist on her and blacken a part of her body, that it really wasn't as bad as what she was saying it was.
I was really afraid at that point because we were married and we had a baby and things were not getting better. So while he was gone for a week, I had become very involved in an affair.
I pulled up in the driveway. And Star met me there with her bags packed with our then 2-year-old daughter, Kylie. And we went through the exchange of, what are you doing? And she says, I'm leaving. I'm like, why? And she's like, are you kidding me? Why? I expected my parents to just receive me with, you know, loving arms. And when I got to their house and explained to them what was going on, they said, if you're going to live in our house, you need to go to marriage counseling. I'd started out that counseling session ranting and raving about how Star was doing this wrong and doing that wrong. I started throwing God's word in there, and that, you know, she's not doing this, she's not respecting me. I mean, the Bible says that I deserve to be respected, right? He took a long pause and he started to read Philippians 2 to me. Jesus came to this earth and deserved everything. He deserved for people to bow down at his feet. He deserved for all the riches in the world, and he had a biblical right to all those things. And yet he chose to take the nature of a servant, and he chose to surrender those rights to God the Father. And as I looked at my life, and I looked at Jesus' life, and I saw the the huge gap in between the two, the lights came on for me. I had accepted Jesus for my forgiveness of my past sins, so that I could spend eternity with him forever. But I was missing the gospel of the now. And I was missing the gospel and its effect and its impact on me today. And from that point on, my anger was in a totally different perspective.
He was changing. And I didn't like that, because everyone either knew or suspected that they knew what I was doing, and he was becoming this great guy, and no one really knew the ins and outs of why I left. We would fight, and I would push all the same buttons, and he did not respond the way that I was used to him responding.
I mean, you have to understand, my life was radically transformed.
I remember being very drawn to the man that he was becoming, but now the relationship was dead. I decided I was going to go to counseling, 2 to 3 sessions, and then be done. That way I can say that I tried and it just didn't work. And so I was going to pursue a divorce. I vented everything to him about why there was just no way that we were going to make it. And he just listened. And then he looked at me in the eye very intently and said, do you believe that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead? And I said, yes, I believe that. He said, you think that God can take a dead man and raise him to life to save you, but you don't think he can heal your marriage? And so I turned to God this much.
It takes 100% dependency on Christ in the moment, in the now. And it looks like constant confession and repentance for me.
A light that had been shut off came on, and I wondered, what if God could do it?
Wow. It's pretty powerful stuff. Don't know if any of you can relate to that or not. So what we're going to do is we're going to, first thing that we're going to do is we're going to do a marriage couple study. And then after that's done, then we contact Family Life back again. And the next step, should God continue to lead us, so we continue to be prayer, we're going to take good some godly counsel, and we're taking this series honestly. The next step would be then we got to go down to Florida in September for new staff training. And that's where they teach you how to raise your support. And it's about a 10-day deal down there, and you have to raise $5,000 plus your transportation down there and back. And so that would be the step after, if God wants us to keep going after we get done with this course. So very intense training down there, Campus Crusade. You've mostly probably heard that. I mean, they take you down there. Remember the days of going to the malls and witnessing and that? That's one of the day things I do. They take you down there and they hit the beach or someplace and they say, go witness to that person. And you got to take a little Bible course. And so it's pretty intense. Because once you pass that, if you can't raise your support for that, that's their way of feeling that you're not called now at that point in time. I don't say you're ever called, but so that's one way that they're seeing that God's leading if you raise your support. And then so once you get past that, then they give you 12 to 18 months to raise your support for the trip down there, the move down there. So that's kind of where it's at. So I've made a sign-up list, and I'm going to pass this around. We're going to have it available for a couple weeks, but if there's anybody that you know now want to take this course, if you just put your name here, and I have a column for host. If you feel, and I'm not holding you, there's no contract or anything written here, but if things change, that's okay, but if you feel you like maybe host it, I mean, we live in Illinois, so it'd be easier for somebody up here to do it, or we could do it at the church, too. But just put a check in there if you feel like you can host it. If there's several hosts, we can rotate homes. That's okay. So if somebody's already got a check and you still like to be a host, go ahead and put a check in there. And then right now we have 4 days. We have a Monday, Friday, Saturday, and a Sunday pick there. So if any of those days work best for you, go ahead and just check that box too. So this is just kind of give us an idea who's interested now and what days would be more convenient for you. So I'll give that to you, Aaron, who's going to pass it on.
I just wanted to add that there is no marriage that God cannot save. And I know of people that have split up and they're in the process of coming back together because of God's grace. So that's something that's very important and near and dear to our hearts. And we do also ask for your prayers as well. That's more important than anything else because it's the obedience to God that matters most, whether we go to Arkansas or we stay up here and work in the church here. Thank you so much.
So the answer is no, we didn't get called down there yet. It was a no, it was a yes, a wait. But we did get called to do this here in this local church with you guys. So that you know for a fact was our calling. So we would appreciate it if you would join Mary and I in this couple study, and see where God takes us. We're going to learn too. I mean, we're just, we're going through this with you. We're just facilitating this whole thing. So it's not that we have all the answers or we profess to have the answers, but this is our calling now, the New Life Bible Church, and we'd love for you to join us. During our last, Mary had mentioned that the last day they split up the women and the men in different ways. During our men's course, when the evaluators are teaching men to be men and to lead our wives, and we need to, it's our responsibility to lead wives. Men, we are to lead our wives. That's what God calls us to do. However, we need to make it easy for them to follow us. Some of us can be jerks at times, and they know that they're supposed to be following us, so we just make it a little more difficult for them. So this is kind of what they're talking about. And during this talk, his name's Randy. This guy used to be a funeral home director. He got a text right during our meeting there from one of his couples that support him, have been supporting him for years. And the text read, "Randy, please pray for me now. My wife was gone last night. She just came home, said she's fallen in love with another man. She wants a divorce. And she's had an affair with this guy for a while." So here's people from the church supporting Randy as a missionary. You know, so it happens. It happens to the best of us guys, gals. I mean, it happens to everybody. So, and he was pretty shaken up by that because it happened to be a good friend of his. And so, marriage is a war. You know, Satan is out there. We have targets on our back. And he's aiming at each one of us. And we need to, just realize in Psalms 127:1, one of the verses that he brought up, it says, unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Amen. So if we're building our house, we're laboring in vain. We need to let God build our house. Mm-hmm. And that's what this study is all about. So, you know, if one of those days don't work for you, sign up anyhow, because we're going to be talking to people. We want to do what's best for you. I mean, like I said, we feel called. This is our calling right now. Whether we take that next step or not, you know, and this is our first step. You know, I don't want to look too far in the future, but, you know, God says about looking into the future. You know, for such a time as this, we're gonna teach a married couple study here. So, thanks for your prayers. Anybody have any questions out there? Otherwise, we'll let Aaron come up and lead us one more song. Any questions? Okay, great.
Thank you.
Still pray. Thanks. Stay tuned.